Flu season is always right around the corner, and although it is predictable, it's also deadly. Seasonal flu can kill more than 500,000 people every year by some estimates, and every year it's a roll of the evolutionary dice with a chance of, sorry, another pandemic. And we actually have a pretty good idea of how the flu kills you. What we don't have is a way to stop it. However, researchers have presented a novel drug candidate that, while it won't stop you from getting the flu, might stop you from dying from it. First, let's do a real quick refresher on the flu. You probably know it as a winter disease. It's most common around October to December in the Northern Hemisphere, and then around April to July in the Southern Hemisphere. The culprit of this winter woe is the influenza A virus. It's sphere-shaped and covered in two kinds of spikes, hemagglutinin and neuraminidase, but we'll call them, for short, H and N. H and N work together so the virus can infect human cells. H latches onto a molecule on the surface of cells, while N helps the virus cut itself in. Different versions of those spikes give each virus variant its name, like H1N1 and H3N2, the two main types that are at the moment responsible for seasonal flu in humans. Then there's H5N1, a type of avian influenza or bird flu, which makes the news distressingly often. It gets attention because it is more deadly than most and is likely to cause a pandemic if it can just work out how to spread from person to person. But regardless of the strain, the flu can kill in three ways. About one-third of flu-related deaths are caused by organ failure during the infection, and another third are due to a second bacterial infection. The remaining third of deaths are caused by the way the immune system reacts to the viral infection, or rather, overreacts. Now, a study published in the journal Nature presents a possible drug that could protect people from that immune overreaction. But to understand how it works, we need to get like a flu's eye view of the situation. The virus needs to infect cells so that it can make more viruses that can infect more cells and make more viruses and so on. Specifically, it infects the cells that line the inside of your lungs. But those cells aren't just looking out for themselves, they need to protect you too. So they will literally self-destruct if it might help you get over the flu. The thing is, you need those cells to breathe, and too much self-destruction leads to severe lung injury and death. Your cells rely on a protein called RIPK3, which is a pretty metal name, to make the tough decisions. And RIPK3 gives the cell two options: the easy way or the hard way. First, the easy way, apoptosis, often called programmed cell death. When RIPK3 shows up, its presence activates some other cellular machinery that causes the cell to collapse. Like expert stagehands disassembling a set, a bunch of enzymes cut apart the cell's proteins and DNA, and a unique signal on the surface of the cell sends the message that other cells can absorb and recycle the pieces. It's a pretty low-key event that doesn't cause too much trouble for your immune system. Easy peasy, apa-squeezy. Cool. So, what's the hard way? Well, that's when RIPK3 brings out the big guns, necroptosis. Unlike apoptosis, necroptosis is an inflammatory cell death. The dead cell gunk isn't packaged up as nicely as it is in apoptosis, and the process releases chemicals that signal, hey, this part of the body is in distress. In response, extra fluid and cells from the blood collect around the damaged cells to try and contain the damage, which is why an inflamed area gets puffy and red. And the immune system sends a flood of even more inflammatory molecules called cytokines. And these, of course, can be useful in small doses to help clear away infections. But with too many cytokines, you can get a cycle of more and more inflammation, which damages organs and is linked to lethal cases of the flu. You may remember how we all had to learn the phrase cytokine storm during COVID. It's pretty much the same thing. Under most circumstances, RIPK3 won't cause necroptosis unless apoptosis is blocked for some reason. But during an influenza infection, RIPK3 causes both apoptosis and necroptosis at the same time. So for years, scientists have been fiddling with RIPK3 to try and find a way that it can still cause apoptosis, but not necroptosis and all the inflammation that comes with it. Luckily, RIPK3 causes those two kinds of cell death in two different ways. For necroptosis, RIPK3 functions as a type of protein called a kinase. Kinases do a very specific thing. They add a chemical tag called a phosphate group to another molecule. That phosphate group touches off some kind of signal and causes something to happen. In the case of RIPK3, that signal tells the cell, okay boys, we are gonna do this the hard way, and necroptosis begins. For apoptosis though, it's simpler. RIPK3 doesn't need its kinase activity. It doesn't pass a phosphate group to anyone. It just rolls out of bed and shows up. So the thinking goes, if you can stop RIPK3's kinase activity, but still have it be there, you can get apoptosis without necroptosis. And in April 2024, a study in the journal Nature presented an experimental drug called UH15-38 that can do exactly that. In mice. They tested a bunch of similar molecules until they found one that interacts with a key part of RIPK3 that does the kinasing. Then they gave it to a group of mice with flu infections. For 4 days, some mice received UH15-38, and others received either other drug candidates or a control. Mice that received the drug saw less lethality and less lung injury from necroptosis after a flu infection compared to those without the drug. No inflammatory cytokines, and the cells that line the lungs were largely safe and sound. Lastly, the researchers confirmed that UH15-38 can prevent necroptosis after a flu infection in human cells in the lab. And in an especially good piece of news, for the mice at least, UH15-38 was useful at least 5 days following infection, unlike other antivirals that need to be given within 2 days to have much impact. Meaning we might have way more time to get it to somebody who needs it. This is really exciting progress toward a treatment that could protect people from deadly flu infections. But of course, there's a lot of work to do before something like this hits the shelves at your local pharmacy. This study all took place in either lab dishes or in mice, and drugs need to go through clinical trials in people and official approval before they reach you and me. And this drug is also specific to flu. It would not be able to protect people from severe cases of COVID-19, for example, because even though the way the infection goes down in your lungs is really similar, necroptosis works differently in COVID. Still, this is a huge step forward for a drug that we badly need. If we could have this drug ready for the next flu pandemic, or even just the next bad flu season, it could make a big difference towards saving many, many lives.